This is a place for crazy people. I'm not crazy.
We don't use that term, crazy, Mr. Cole.
I know some things that you don't know. It's going to be very difficult for you to understand it.
We appreciate your volunteering. You're a very good observer, Cole.
Thank you.
Did you see this when you went back?
No, sir, I don't think so.
What about these people? Did you see any of these people?
No. No. Oh, wait. Wait.
Him? You saw that man?
Maybe in the mental institution.
I can help you. You want me to, don't you? Get you out.
I need to go. I need to. I'm supposed to be gathering information.
What kind of information?
Won't help you. Won't help anyone. Won't change anything. 5 billion people died in 1996 and 1997. Most the entire population of the world. About 1% of us survived.
Are you going to save us, Mr. Cole?
How can I save you? This already happened. I can't save you. Nobody can. I'm simply trying to gather information to help the people in the present trace the path of the virus.
You said that I had delusions, that I created this world. You said you could explain it.
I can't! I'm trying to.
You're a rational person. You're a trained psychiatrist. You know the difference between what's real and what's not.
I want the future to be unknown.
Twelve Monkeys arrived late December of 1995 for limited screenings, and in early January of 96 it got its wide release. Costing about $30 million, it recouped around $168 million worldwide, making it director Terry Gilliam's most successful movie at the box office to this day. With its strong box office results, it was also very successful with critics, with many praising it for its story premise, unique ideas and performances from the stars Bruce Willis and Brad Pitt. Terry Gilliam was a director for hire. He didn't have any involvement with the script, but wanted to maintain his vision and cinematic style throughout. However, he had not proven successful in the Hollywood system. A lot of the studios never really grasped his vision and style, and most of the time failed to market his movies correctly. Gilliam experienced studio problems on Brazil, with Universal wanting to edit his movie and create a happy ending. This caused a public display of anger between Terry and the studio, further discouraging involvement with Mr. Gilliam. Terry is always vocal about his frustration with how he is treated, and overall vision when it comes to making movies, which always makes his interviews and film documentaries so fascinating to watch. Being involved again with Universal for 12 Monkeys, they gave him full cut on the movie, but he had to make sure the film was delivered on time, and there were no cost overruns. David and Janet Peoples wrote the movie. David, as many know, worked on Blade Runner. The screenplay was inspired by the 1962 short film La Jetée, which was shot entirely with still photographs. It's about a prisoner in the aftermath of World War III in a post-apocalyptic Paris, where the survivors live underground. The scientists research time travel, hoping to send test subjects to different time periods to save the future. They have difficulty finding subjects who can mentally withstand the shock of time travel. The prisoner the scientists choose is the key to the past. He has a vague but obsessive memory from his pre-war childhood of a woman he had seen on the observation platform at an airport, shortly before witnessing the death of a man. The movie really got into full swing once the main stars were cast. The budget for the film wasn't large, but certainly wasn't small. Many of the actors took a pay cut to be involved, especially because Terry was directing. You'd be stupid to turn down a film being handled by Gilliam. There are three main stars the film focuses around. Bruce Willis, already well known for his action roles and a huge box office star, plays James Cole. He is sent back in time to gather information about a virus that has wiped out the majority of the world's population. This role gave Bruce the opportunity to play a character far more mentally unstable and emotional, breaking away from his action roots. Brad Pitt, who was becoming a hot property in Hollywood after his performance in Seven, which was critically praised. His character is called Jeffrey Goines, who is a total nutter. Bruce's character first meets Jeffrey in a mental asylum. His performance earned him an Academy Award nomination, and it certainly is one of my favourites from Brad Pitt. Some reports say Terry Gilliam took away Brad's cigarettes, which helped him bring out his manic and erratic performance.
Drugs!
Madeline M. Stowe plays Catherine Riley. She takes on Cole as her patient in the asylum. She becomes the only person to eventually believe Cole and his warnings of the spread of the virus, and she begins to find clues to his predictions. James Cole awakes from a dream about the past, witnessing the murder of a man in an airport, which haunts him throughout the movie. Cole is a convicted criminal living beneath a post-apocalyptic Philadelphia in the year 2035. In 1996 and early 97, the Earth's surface has been contaminated by a virus so deadly it wiped out the majority of the world's population. The remaining survivors were forced to move underground. In the years that followed, scientists had engineered an imprecise form of time travel. For Cole to earn a pardon for his crimes and for being a good observer, he agrees to allow the scientists to send him on the dangerous missions to the past to collect information on the virus, thought to have been released by a terrorist organisation known as the Army of the 12 Monkeys. If possible, he has to obtain a pure sample of the original virus so that a cure can be developed. Cole arrives in Baltimore in 1990, not 1996 as planned. He is arrested and shoved into a mental institution on the diagnosis of Catherine. There he encounters Jeffrey, a fellow mental patient with fanatical animal rights and anti-consumerist thoughts. Cole tries unsuccessfully to leave a voicemail on a number monitored by the scientists in the future. After an escape attempt, Cole is locked in a cell, but seemingly disappears, returning to the future. Back in his own time, the scientists play a distorted voicemail message to Cole, which gives the location of the Army of the 12 Monkeys. They strongly believe that they are responsible for the virus. He is also shown photos of numerous people suspected of being involved, including Jeffrey, whom he recognises from the past. Down to Cole's experience and knowledge of the past, they decide to send him back. First, he arrives in a French trench during World War I, where Cole is shot in the leg before successfully being transported to 1996. Cole locates and kidnaps Catherine, forcing her to take him to Philadelphia, where they learn that Jeffrey is the founder of the Army of the 12 Monkeys. Cole eventually finds him after gathering information from Jeffrey's followers. Jeffrey denies any involvement with the virus and suggests that wiping out humanity was Cole's idea all along, from when he was in the asylum in 1990. The film's score was composed, arranged and conducted by English musician Paul Buckmaster. The main theme is apparently based on Argentinian tango music, which to me kind of sounds very French in its design and execution. Paul is best known for his work with the music industry, working with David Bowie and Elton John. He hasn't composed many films, but I'm sure many viewers will know of the Peter Pan and the Pirates cartoon from the early 90s, which has an amazing theme tune attached. The score itself is very atmospheric and isn't full of large-scale action cues, because obviously the movie doesn't focus on any action, so the music really is there to set the mood and create parallels between the past and present. The composer felt the audience shouldn't be made aware of the music too much, but let it drive the emotions as they get wrapped up in the story. The most beautiful part of the score is the music for the dream sequences. They tempt the film with an existing violin piece and built upon it to create their musical motif for those sequences. The soundtrack doesn't appear to be available on iTunes or Amazon to download, so you'll have to do some hunting around on eBay to find it. It's definitely worth a listen, so it's certainly recommended. When you first watch 12 Monkeys, the story is laid out in a straightforward way from the beginning. They begin in the present, our future, and go back to the past. You know what's going on, but in typical Terry Gilliam fashion, things begin to get confusing and the audience is taken down a different path. That gives the film its ambiguity. By the end, you come out thinking Cole was insane or Catherine had lost the plot. Many people were left unsure about the film's ending. It's certainly not obvious and happy, but because Cole manages to find out the true creator of the virus, they can send the scientists from the future and she ends up sitting next to Dr. Peters on the plane. This is as Cole had indicated in the car to Catherine, that once he finds enough information, they will send someone back to work on the antidote. So if anyone was confused at all by the ending of The Lady Next to Dr. Peters, now you know. But everyone has their own ideas on what the real meaning is behind the film's ending and Cole's sanity. There are many scenes and bits of dialogue to confuse you along the way. The set pieces of the future have this sort of steampunk design and similar visuals to French cinema and such films as The City of Lost Children. But you're not shown much beyond what Cole sees. You spend most of the time in a few rooms under the city with the scientists. As an audience member, you want to see what's beyond that. We are told that Cole is given a pardon for his crimes because he has helped uncover more clues to the virus, so what happens to him now? How does the remaining population live? This is all done for good reasons, by showing less, and only through the eyes of Cole, you are left further wondering about Cole's mental state. There are parts I'm still unsure about, such as the disembodied voice talking to Cole in the future while he is being locked up and later when he is in bed. This creepy voice reveals a lot about what has transpired in the past and questions Cole about his actions. Could this be James's subconscious thought? But when he travels to the past, he encounters a homeless man with the same voice. He knows about Cole and the scientists in the future and recommends that he remove some of his teeth to avoid being tracked. However, later on, Catherine bumps into the tramp and he doesn't know anything about Cole and the events from earlier. If this tramp was in Cole's mind, then how does Catherine see him and later on question him about James's whereabouts? It is also indicated that there are others from the future who are stuck there. The homeless guy says you can't be tracked if you remove your teeth. That could imply there are many others who are wandering around from the future. One of the mad protesters shouts to Cole that he is one of us. You have quick shots of the security guard in the future being seen in the past by Cole, further adding that he is delusional and seeing things. These are further pieces to the puzzle. 12 Monkeys nicely homages Alfred Hitchcock's Vertigo as they change their clothes to hide from the authorities. Towards the end of the film, James and Catherine hide in a theatre showing a 24-hour Hitchcock marathon and watch a scene from Vertigo. Catherine then changes her appearance with a blonde wig, as Judy transformed herself into blonde Madeline in Vertigo. Cole sees her emerge within a red light, and Scotty saw Judy emerge within a green light, and brief parts of Bernard Herrmann's score can also be heard as well. I don't think the romance is that strong in the film, and by the end I always felt like Catherine suddenly fell in love with James. Her line, "I remember you like this, and I felt like I've known you before," in the scene where they've just changed into their disguises. That line of dialogue is very confusing. Has she had dreams of the future and what transpired? There's a great moment where Brad Pitt's character implies he was inspired by James Cole's idea of a future where the virus has taken over and only animals are left to rule the world. So Cole and the audience is left thinking he caused the events, but then you have the problem of how does the virus spread in the future if they hadn't sent Cole back. Oh, my brain hurts now. This is the problem with dealing with time travel premises, you end up crossing over timelines and confusing yourself. But this sequence really is only in to provide yet another twist to the final reveal that it wasn't the 12 monkeys that spread the virus. I love films that are thought-provoking, and after viewing it you're left with questions on how things transpire. It's not to say I like movies that are totally confusing, usually down to being fundamentally flawed with its direction and story. 12 Monkeys doesn't suffer from that, but what this movie has in its favour is that the more you watch it, the more the answers to your questions are revealed. It's not directed in a way that it holds your hand and makes things easy for you. It's one step ahead all the time, and you have to keep up. I don't personally think it's Terry Gilliam's best film. I kind of favour Brazil and Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas. 12 Monkeys is still certainly a very good movie, and a strong science fiction thriller. The performances are all very solid, as usual in all of Terry's films. I don't think I have any major problems with it. I've rewatched it a handful of times. I do think, however, it does sag a little near the middle. Once Cole has kidnapped Catherine, I kind of want the story to move along a bit quicker. It would have been good to have more of a sense of a countdown to the eventual scene at the airport, to help create a bit more tension and suspense. If you haven't seen it, go and pick it up. It's easy to obtain on DVD and Blu-ray. It comes with a fantastic documentary about the making of the film, and has great insights to the editing process and how the movie tested with audiences. Terry Gilliam always displays his frustration with feedback and a process involved in filmmaking, but his views and opinions are always great to listen to. 12 Monkeys is a smart flick that requires you to look deep into its story, and I believe it requires repeated viewing just to get the full sense of what it's trying to do. It's a film I'd always be happy to return to. There is always going to be something you've missed, and just the way it looks makes it more inviting. It's got Terry Gilliam's visual style all over it. He makes great use of those wide lenses and shoots things at interesting angles, very much like Brazil. If you have seen it, I hope maybe I've revealed something you haven't noticed before in the film, or just feel encouraged to watch it again. It's great to watch a smart movie with a sci-fi twist. There isn't just mindless action and violence. It's a Terry Gilliam movie, and it needs to be in your collection.
You can't trick us, you know. It wouldn't work.
No, sir.
You haven't become addicted, have you, Cole? To that dying world?
No, sir. I just want to do my part to get us back on top in charge of the planet. And I have the experience. I know the people involved.
He really is the most qualified. But all that being lazy.
You said we weren't real, Cole.
I don't think the human mind is meant to exist in two different, whatever you called it, dimensions?
He's sick, okay? He thinks he comes from the future. He's been living in a meticulously constructed fantasy world, and that world is starting to disintegrate. He needs help.
Have any of you heard of the army of the 12 monkeys? They paint with it. Stencil this on the sides of buildings everywhere.
In psychiatry, it's the latest religion. We decide what's right and wrong. We decide who's crazy or not.
Hey, I'm not crazy anymore. No. I mean, I am. No. I'm mentally divergent. I know that now.
What does this mean to you?
About this.
You had a bullet from World War I in your leg, James. How did it get there?
I don't know.
We live underground! The world belongs to dogs and cats!
We live like worms!
Dr. Goins' assistant, he's an apocalypse nut! I saw him a minute ago, I think he's involved!
Don't forget, you can still buy the poster celebrating 100 retrospectives. You can find a link in the description box below or by visiting my website. If you enjoyed the video, you can find more by clicking on these videos and by subscribing to my channel. If you want to gain access to reviews and commentaries early, you can donate through Patreon.